Pidato ini oleh Profesor Dr. Peter Agui.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor Dr. Peter Agui.
Assalamu alaikum. Good morning. It is a great honor to be here at ITV. This is something my wife Mary and I have been looking forward to, and you have no idea how much it pleases us to be with you. But we live in dangerous times. As an American scientist and some in my country speak aggressively against Islam, it is a pleasure to be in the largest Muslim country in the world to talk about something we all love, science. It brings us together. So I'm going to spend the next 40
minutes myself presenting an update of the Nobel lecture. This was a lecture I presented in Stockholm in 2003. And I think it'll project behind me. Now, I was understanding there'd be a clicker so I could advance the slides. Oh, is it left? Thank you. We did not rehearse this. Thank you. Water, the solvent of life. Without water, there's no life. We hear much about water in terms of planetary water, melting of the ice cap, warming of the seawater. We don't hear so much in the press about water in biology. And all of us are primarily water, two-thirds of our body mass. Every one of us, two-thirds of our body mass is water. Water is the major component of every cell and every tissue of our body. Yet water moves throughout our bodies. And while we're here together this morning, we'll each be synthesizing cerebrospinal fluid in our brain, absorbing it, synthesizing aqueous humor in our eyes, absorbing it, releasing a thin film of tears, salivating, sweating, humidifying our airways, concentrating our urine. So it is something nature has taken very seriously and designed a plumbing system for water in our bodies. I'll get this right. With the discovery of the plasma membrane encapsulating each cell of our bodies, it was predicted that water would pass through the cell membranes by simple diffusion. If you look at the upper left figure, water trickling through the membrane bilayer. But this is not enough to explain massive movements of water in certain tissues, such as renal tubules in our kidneys, secretory glands, and red cells. And it was predicted, not by me, but by other scientists, that there must be water-selective channels. So if you look at the upper right panel, you see what we call aquaporin water channels. And it was the discovery of the aquaporins that brought me the Nobel, and has advanced science far beyond what our own laboratory did. The movement of water through the aquaporins is by simple osmosis, something that every school child learns about at school. Osmosis occurs in all cells, but in some cells very rapidly because of the aquaporins. Now, as was mentioned in the introduction, the discovery of the aquaporins recognized a 28 kilodalton polypeptide. And I won't go through the technical details because you're scientists and some of you have already read the papers, but in fact, what this represented was a serendipitous observation, an unexpected discovery, because we were studying the rhesus blood group antigens and found a second protein which we didn't know was there. Scientists all over the world, here at ITB and elsewhere, are constantly making discoveries which they did not expect. So the discovery involved the cloning of the complementary DNA expressing this new protein. And we studied the predicted sequence. It was thought to encode a membrane-spanning protein. And if you look at the upper right, that's meant to represent the lipid bilayer. with a protein going through the membrane 6 times. But we didn't know the function of this protein. In the genetics database, when we did this work in the early 1990s, which to me doesn't seem so long ago, to the young people, the students, of course, that's a long time ago, the database contained a series of DNAs encoding similar proteins in diverse organisms, in the lens of eye of beef cattle, brains of insects, bacteria, and plants. What could these all share? And it may seem obvious now, but in the beginning we didn't know what it shared. But it was a conversation with a generous scientist at the University of North Carolina that gave us the idea this might be the long-sought water channel that causes renal tubules and red cells to be so permeable to water. And so we did a simple experiment. Scientists make their living by doing simple experiments. So if you look at the panel on the upper left, you'll see two spherical objects. These are frog eggs, Xenopus laevis, a millimeter in diameter. And frogs lay eggs in the springtime all over the world. I'm sure here in Indonesia, frogs are laying eggs right now. But if frog eggs are not fertilized, they're dormant and have very low water permeability. So the idea was very simple. In the upper left, we have a control oocyte injected with buffer alone. In the upper right, we have an oocyte injected with the complementary RNA for this new protein. They're cultured together, and there's no obvious difference. Now, of course, as scientists, you all recognize the culture medium is isotonic. If we transfer now to distilled water, there'll be an osmotic gradient. The control oocyte should not swell. The test oocyte should swell and explode, exactly what happened, producing much jubilation in the laboratory. This is something scientists share all over the world, a discovery. No matter the magnitude of the discovery, something new produces jubilation. And this is Greg Preston, the postdoc who helped us with these early studies. We've functionally verified that, in fact, this was the water channel by reconstituting into synthetic membranes. And the micrographs shown here, collaboration with our colleagues in Denmark, shows the reconstitution of simple membrane vesicles in the upper left, smooth surfaces. In the lower left, we have reconstitution of the pure protein. If you look, there'll be bumps on the surface of these vesicles. And we tested them for the ability to shrink after rapid transfer. You can see that the upper tracing reaches equilibrium in about a half a second. In the lower right tracing, it reaches equilibrium in just a few milliseconds, in an instant. So the aquaporins really explain the velocity of water movement. And we worked very hard to establish the structure. And the structure, which we refer to as the hourglass model, shows that the 6 bilayer spanning domains, which exist actually as an internal repeat. If you look closely, the sequence has 3 bilayer spanning domains and 3 more in the opposite orientation. And if they fold together, they form a single aqueous pour down through the center of the molecule, the water channel. And in collaboration with other scientists around the world, we're really a community of scientists. In our studies initially with Yoshinori Fujiyoshi from Kyoto on the left and Andreas Engel from the Biozentrum in Basel, Switzerland, allowed us to establish the structure at high resolution. In the upper left, to the left panel, you'll see a single membrane spanning aquaporin subunit with a hole in the center. That hole in the center is 3 angstroms in diameter, precisely large enough to allow a single water molecule to pass. And by diagram, we demonstrate the function here. The upper vestibule, the extracellular vestibule, and the inner vestibule contain water in bulk solution. Water, of course, in nature, is a liquid because of hydrogen bonding between water molecules. But in the very center, you'll see that water moves through the narrowest part of the channel in single file with barriers to prevent the movements of charged solutes and larger solutes. And this is work of a young scientist. This is always the work of young scientists. Scientists here in Bandung and around the world are what make the scientific progress. And by space filling representation, you can see a single water molecule filling the center cavity surrounded by special residues to prevent the movement of other solutes and solvents. So as a physician, I, of course, was very interested in the human physiology. And we teamed up again with other young scientists. This is Søren Nielsen from the University of Aarhus in Denmark, a superb microscopist with whom we worked together to localize the presence of the aquaporin protein, and it's in the proximal nephron. The diagram of the nephron on the left shows that the glomerulus leads to the descending thin limb of the loop of Henle, where the aquaporin proteins are abundantly expressed. And if you look at a thin section in the lower left, there's a micrograph showing a tubule in transverse section. The protein is present in the luminal membrane and the abdominal membrane. And this basically allows water to cross the cell membranes. And by diagram form in this figure, you can see a single cell in a renal tubule epithelium allowing water from above the primary urine to pass through the cell carried by aquaporin 1. And our bodies are extremely efficient in doing this every day. Every day, each of us will filter about 200 liters of plasma and reabsorb 99% of the water because this is such an efficient system. Now, as a physician, we were also interested in specific disease relevance. And there was work of a young scientist, Shulso Moon, from Seoul National University, who was a graduate student in our laboratory, who identified the structural gene for aquaporin 1 in the short arm of chromosome 7, coincident with the structural gene for a blood group antigen, Coltan. And this allowed us to determine that the Coltan antigen was a polymorphism in the aquaporin 1 protein. And with that, we were able to identify the rarest individuals lacking the Coltan blood group antigen and having mutations in the aquaporin 1 gene. And in fact, these people look and feel pretty normal. In this photograph, with permission, is a retired school teacher from the south of France who has a mutation in her aquaporin 1 genes. She can't make the protein. And if you look at the panel in the far right, you'll see the ability of all of us, normal individuals, to concentrate our urine after overnight thirsting to about 1,000 milliosmolar. But to the left of that, you see that the aquaporin 1 null individuals can only concentrate to about 400 milliosmolar. They cannot concentrate their urine fully, which means they're releasing dilute urine in the face of dehydration. If they did not have access to water, if they did not have access to the solvent of life, they would die of dehydration long before any of us would become symptomatic. And the protein is also present in the capillaries throughout our bodies. And this is an interesting experiment undertaken by our colleague Landon King at Johns Hopkins in collaboration with other scientists at Hopkins using a technique developed by a young scientist from Algeria who came to Johns Hopkins. His name is Elias Zerhouni. You may recognize that name. Zerhouni became the director of the National Institutes of Health. These images represent high-resolution CT scans of the lung. And if you look closely, there's an open structure with an L over it. That's a bronchiole, a breathing tubule, and adjacent to it is a venule. And the panel to the left shows baseline, and to the right, the same structures after infusion of physiological saline. And what happens is the fluid is released from the venule surrounding the bronchiole, and this is something that is very different when we look at normal individuals compared to the aquaporin 1 null individuals. The null individuals cannot release fluid from their venules. They can't move water into and out of air spaces. And of course, this is going to be of great importance at the time of birth. So we were joined by other scientists, both collaborators and competitors, to identify aquaporins. Our interest was in human aquaporin repertoire, but scientists around the world established that aquaporins are present in every life form, every microorganism, every plant. Every form of life has an aquaporin. And our colleagues took great interest in the kidney and pursued the vasopressin-regulated water channel in the distal nephron. And this explains the final concentration of urine. And I won't go through this in any detail because of the nature of the audience today. In fact, the vasopressin, the neurohormone released when we sense thirst, allows the protein to move to the cell surface and concentrate the urine maximally. Another member of the family, studied by Masato Yasui, a postdoctoral fellow from Japan, who came to Johns Hopkins. He's now back in Japan as the chairman of pharmacology at Keio University. And mutations in the lens homolog, aquaporin 0, lead to cataracts in small children. Another member of the family, aquaporin 4, present in a number of tissues, including brain, which we studied in collaboration with Ole Petter Ottersen and his colleagues in Norway. And the aquaporin 4 is present in the pericapillary astroglial end feed in brain. I don't know if it projects well, but that's precisely the blood-brain barrier, where fluid moving from blood space into brain, or back from brain into blood space, is regulated by the presence of aquaporin 4. And in a very interesting study undertaken by a young scientist in Ole Petter's group, Mahmoud Amiri, he established that, in fact, mutations in the aquaporin 4 gene protect against brain damage after brain injury. Mahmoud started his career, very interestingly, as a refugee in Pakistan. His family was Iranian. They had fled persecution. He was adopted by the Norwegian social services, became an outstanding medical student, now is a leading European neuroscientist. And this observation indicates that if we could develop inhibitors to aquaporin 4, we would have a new tool to prevent or treat brain edema, which is a tragic problem following head injury, stroke, or brain tumor. Here is the image of an individual with a brain tumor. If you look on the upper left, you'll see the MRI imaging has a large opaque structure. This is a meningioma causing symptoms. If you look at the right, the same images by MRI with the water-weighted image, you see surrounding the tumor is what we call brain edema. And when the brain tumor was removed, the edema persisted. It's a very difficult problem. So we're heartened by the discovery of aquaporin 4 in brain and hopeful that we'll be able to develop new inhibitors that allow us to prevent or treat brain edema. Yet another member of the family, aquaporin 5, present in secretory glands. Secretory glands release tears, sweat, and saliva. And these protect us from the damages of thermal expression. In the heat of the day, we protect ourselves by sweating. By sweating, we cool ourselves. And in this study, we have of two mice, on the left, the paw of a normal mouse, and on the right, the paw of an aquaporin 5 null mouse, a genetic knockout, we find that the null mouse has sweat glands which don't function. And that mouse is vulnerable to heat stroke, whereas the wild-type mouse can sweat and protect itself. In addition to the water channel proteins, the aquaporins, there are similar proteins referred to as aquaglyceroporins. These are permeated by water plus glycerol, the three-carbon polyol. And the presence of the aquaglyceroporins in the basal levels of skin have profound significance. Now, I was visited a few years ago by the executives from the Christian Dior company. I don't normally get a lot of visitors from the Christian Dior company, and was a little suspicious their motivation for seeking me out. And they wanted me to present a lecture in Paris to coincide with the release of a beauty product called Hydraction Skin Cream. And I have to point out, I have no financial ties to Christian Dior. They offered some, but there were a lot of strings attached. And as scientists, our object is actually the pursuit of knowledge, not the pursuit of strings, which might bring some temporary financial windfall. This was the back cover of the Marie Claire beauty magazine. And I imagine you can't read it, but some of the statements are very bold. Talked about spectacular hydration. And at the very bottom it mentions the Nobel Prize in Chemistry. I showed this to my mother, who was at that time about 80 years old. My mother was never able to go to a university. She was a farm girl. When she saw this, she smiled and said, "Peter, I think you're finally doing something useful." Well, our mothers know us better than we know ourselves. I hope some of the work is useful. And we are now heartened by some of the new discoveries. For example, the discovery of the aquaporin 7, the aquaglyceroporin in fat that allows us to release glycerol when we're fasted or starved. We have a new disease in the United States and in Western Europe. It's obesity. This used to be extremely uncommon in children, and now is dreadfully common. We're genetically programmed to efficiently store extra calories as fat. triglycerides. And the aquaglyceroporin 7 protein allows glycerol release from fat when we're fasted or starved, where it's taken up by the liver. And the micrograph on the far right shows aquaglyceroporin 9. And when glycerol enters fat, it's returned into glucose. This is work of Jen Carberry. Now, in some parts of the world, particularly in Bangladesh, groundwater is toxic because the groundwater is contaminated with high levels of arsenic. Drinking pure water, of course, is essential. And the aquaglyceroporins are permeated by arsenite, and we believe evolutionarily this is a mechanism which prevents us from arsenic toxicity by allowing us to excrete arsenic, which we might take in from groundwater, excrete it into the bile. This is a very easy one to understand. Aquaporins are present in plants. And on the far right is an Arabidopsis, a small mustard plant. And notice the foliage. It's lush, green, but it only requires a thin arborization of rootlets. On the left is an Arabidopsis plant which has been genetically engineered so that the rootlets have only 20% of the normal amount of the water channel protein. But it maintains stem turgor and a nice foliage because the plant compensates. Each rootlet has fewer aquaporins, so it sends out more rootlets. This tells us something we already knew. Plants compete for water. And while here in Bandung, water supply is plentiful, in many parts of the world, water supply is not plentiful. The development of crops that are drought resistant could be of great value. Bacteria also contain aquaporins. And some of these bacterial homologs are now being reconstituted into synthetic membranes as artificial water purifiers, the most efficient purification system known to man, the aquaporins. Now, in October of 2003, early in the morning, the phone rang. A very pleasant Swedish voice on the other end of the phone. I'll never forget it. This is an important telephone call from Stockholm for Professor Peter Agri. Are you Professor Agri? I thought I know who this was. So I said, I sure am, and they identified themselves as the Nobel Chemistry Committee. They explained I would share the Nobel Chemistry Prize with Roderick MacKinnon, who is also a medical doctor. Rod works at Rockefeller University on ion channels. And they explained what the prize was about and said, in 10 minutes, we'll have a press conference. You should get ready for your day. 10 minutes, that's not a lot of time to prepare for your day at 5:30 in the morning. But I sprinted to the shower, got ready for my day, and my dear wife, Mary, used that moment to call my mother back in Minnesota. My father, who was a chemistry professor, had died 8 years before. Mother, living alone, awakened early in the morning to learn that her son would receive a Nobel Prize. She said to Mary, tell Peter that's very nice, but don't let this go to his head. Our mothers have good advice. There are more important things than doing science, and that's doing something useful. And by the time I got to the laboratory that morning, the young people were celebrating. The phone voicemail was jammed with requests for interviews from the New York Times, the television media. And there was a very familiar voice, one of our friends from Norway. I'll never forget the voice. It said, Peter, Peter, we've just heard the news. It's unbelievable. And then there's a pause. And the voice comes back, we believe it, we believe it. It's wonderful. And here we are celebrating on the stage after the receipt of the prize, Mary with me, our four children, and holding the medal. But let me point out, the prize itself goes to an individual or two or three, but it's for a discovery that really includes many other people, members of the laboratory, of collaborating laboratories, of competing laboratories. And I believe the real value of the Nobel is to raise the awareness of the public for the value of science, because over the years, the award of the Nobel went for the discovery of insulin, for the discovery of penicillin, and many dozens of other discoveries. And they're continuing to be made. They're being made around the world. They're being made here at ITB. I'll talk just in a moment about the aquaporins in malaria. Red cells permeated by glycerol, which is important in the manifestations of malaria because it allows the intracellular parasite to grow and divide. This is work of Dominique Promenier, a French national working in our lab. It allows a single parasite, if you look in the center, there's a single parasite, to grow and divide into 32 daughter cells. So we have a rapid amplification of the parasites producing horrific fevers. And by knocking out the aquaglycerporins in parasite, we can diminish the infection. Probably not enough to be a good drug target, but that's research. You never know till you do the experiments the outcome. But we're studying the aquaporins in mosquitoes. I know you have mosquitoes here in Indonesia. The mosquitoes manage water very carefully through their own aquaporin channels. And we're studying them. We hope this may be of some practical value, we don't know. I'll skip through the specifics here. But a surprise is that if we reduce one of the specific aquaporins in mosquitoes, they're no longer infected as efficiently by malaria. Maybe this could be a very interesting development which prevents the mosquitoes from passing malaria to people. So at the end of our career, and I'm clearly at the end of my career, and I look back, I think of the studies in the laboratory, the discoveries, and I'm very proud of them. But you know, more important than the studies were the people who did them. The young people who came from around the world to our laboratory and returned to their home countries, many of them. The young scientists we're meeting all around the world, here in Bandung and elsewhere, because that's the important part of science. And I'll end with sharing a little wisdom. Those who understand the Chinese language will recognize that crisis is not a single character, but two characters. Wei, a time of danger. Ji, a time of opportunity. And the dangers of global climate change, of drug resistant tuberculosis, of other pestilences, these are dangers for which science ongoing here at ITB and other institutions, provide an opportunity to make the world a better place. And with that, let me thank you from the bottom of my heart for the honor that I'm about to receive today, an honorary doctorate from your prestigious institution. And let me challenge the young people, go for it in science. Thank you.
Selanjutnya, sesi tanya-jawab akan dipandu oleh Eni Ratnaningsi, PhD.
Question and answer session moderated by Eni Ratnaningsi, PhD.
Well, magnificent aquaporin water channel. Okay, now, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, now it's time for us to have a dialogue with Professor Peter Agri. Would that be a question, comments, or things to be discussed from the audiences? It could be delivered in Indonesian or in English, but it's better in English. Okay, I will divide this dialogue into sessions, and in each session we will collect three questions or comments. Okay, one from the middle, second from the right side of me, and third from probably from the left side. Okay, would you please kindly mention your name and your institution? Questions is to Professor Peter Agri. Eh?
Good morning, Mr. Dr. Peter Agri. I'm Grace Aprilia Helena from biology major in Bandung Institute of Technology. I've got two questions to ask. First, how did you feel when you managed to discover something so remarkable as aquaporins? I mean, you managed to solve the riddle of aquaporins. Did it change you in some ways? And then the second question, how did you manage to make an interdisciplinary approach in your research? I mean, as a soon-to-be scientist, we have to have that kind of way of thinking in our research later at the end of our study. And how did you manage that way of think? How did you manage to that way of thinking? I mean, you managed to put. To lead the team of geneticists and biochemists and everything, and finally you find something so remarkable as aquaporins, and your advice is for us soon to be scientists, especially biologists. Thank you very much.
Thank you for those wonderful questions. The first question is, how did we feel after we discovered the aquaporins? Well, we were very happy, needless to say, but in truth, we knew this was a significant discovery. We had no idea how much interest there would be because we were a small laboratory. Johns Hopkins is a famous institution, but it has many laboratories, and many of them are very small laboratories. So we were not the so-called big guys in the field. And make an observation, it's nice, it's pleasant, it doesn't have to be a world-shaking significance to be exciting and positive. But the importance really grew with the recognition by others and the requests for lectures all around the world. And so it was a little bit staggering, the interest. We tried to remain focused and did so. We could only continue in this field by competing with big laboratories, and we did so by collaborating with other laboratories. And therein lies a great lesson in science. You don't have to be the biggest or best funded to do something important, but you might have to team up with other experts whose techniques complement your own. So we set about pursuing specific projects and teamed up with others. Some were introduced to us by friends or made their own introductions. And I have to say, one advantage I felt I had is that my scientific training was broad, not completely narrow in one subject. And a second advantage is I have three brothers and two sisters, which in the US is a rather large family. And when you're one of six kids, you learn how to get along with others. Yeah. Particularly being of medium height in a Norwegian family, my brothers and sisters are all much bigger than I am. And I think to maintain friendly relations and interact and engage other laboratories where you share and you share credit is a very joyful experience. And scientists truly are in our laboratory, in collaborating laboratories, and in competing laboratories. I showed some of the structural work on the aquaporin protein. One major advance was achieved by a scientist named Bing Yap from Lawrence Berkeley Laboratories. Bing Yap is an Indonesian scientist now working in the United States. So I think the composite of our friends, our competitors, led to, I think, a rapid advancement that we could never have done alone. I hope I answered your question. Thank you.
Thank you. Bersama kita bisa. Okay. Okay, right. The next question. From the left side. Yeah. Questions or comments? Questions.
Good morning, Mr. Peter Akre. My name is Irvin Ofalarosi. I'm the first year student of Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Science here. I have several questions. The first thing is, in your perspective as scientists, how cells evolutionarily develop aquaporin, and if there's life elsewhere outside the Earth, do you think that it will have aquaporin too? My second question is, if aquaporin get mutated, how it can be fixed by the cell itself, or maybe through medicine? And lastly, who's your favorite scientist? Thank you.
I tried to quickly jot these down. First question, how do cells by evolution pass the aquaporins? And I think the implication is anything shared amongst all life forms must have existed in a very early life form. The first primitive cell, the first protobacteria that lived probably in the sea, must have expressed something very similar to the aquaporins, but maybe it was just half of the molecule. Because I tried to indicate the molecule has an internal repeat with three bilayer spanning domains in each direction, and they invert. So there must have been a hemiaquaporin. But this is lost in the genetic record. There's no surviving species that we know of that has a hemiaquaporin that could give us more clues. So sometimes science leads to specific information, but we can't always get back to the absolute beginning, the dawn of creation. But I think the conference of ability to rapidly respond to osmotic shifts must have had an advantage that allowed this to be passed along. And so the same molecule expressed in our brains is a very similar molecule is present in the roots of plants. Our brains and plants are very different, but the ability to move water selectively is something that's shared. Now I believe the second question is, how could this be used to do something useful? It makes me think my mother must have called you, because that's what she'd want you to ask. Something useful. Because the citizens in all countries pay taxes, and the taxes provide grants to wonderful universities like ITB. And in the end, it's not simply academic information, but the use of that information to improve the lives is what we're really after. And so I think the development of possible water purification systems using aquaporins in synthetic membranes may be useful. I think the obvious development of inhibitors of brain water channels, and I talked about that a little bit in the beginning, or in the middle of the talk, the idea of brain edema, the swelling of a brain that occurs after an injury or a stroke or a tumor. It's oftentimes the brain swelling that determines the survival or death of the patient. If we could develop and utilize inhibitors of aquaporin 4, we may have a way of preventing considerable brain damage after these events, which are tragically very common. And the last question is, who is my favorite scientist? Well, I have to say, sort of our family hero was a man named Linus Pauling. And Linus Pauling was a friend of my father's. He stayed at our house when we were children. He is the only scientist to have 2 unshared Nobel Prizes. He made many discoveries, including the structures of proteins, the alpha helix, the beta sheet. He also discovered sickle hemoglobin, and he won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1954. He also was an advocate of using science for the well-being of mankind, and an early scientist to recognize the strong dangers of development of thermonuclear weapons. Back when I was a child in the 1950s, the United States, the Soviets, and the Chinese were detonating huge hydrogen bombs, terrifically powerful, releasing fallout into the atmosphere, a huge toxin. And the governments were competing because they wanted world dominance, but the public of all countries were suffering. And it was really Linus Pauling that led the world protest against thermonuclear war development, and for which he was the recipient of the Nobel Prize in 1963. And Uwe Morawiec, the chair of the International Peace Foundation, informs me that Linus Pauling was one of their first dialogues participants. So we share scientific heroes, and I think that's not a bad thing, particularly for young scientists, to have someone that motivates them. I hope I answered your questions.
Okay, now the third question from the left side. Yes, please.
Okay. Good morning, Professor Agri. My name is Rizal Ananda Sugianto from biology major in Bandung Institute of Technology, and I have 2 questions for you. So the first, I would like to know if there are any differences of aquaporin of humans compared to those of animals, mainly amphibians and reptiles. And the second question is related to amphibians. Does any sort of aquaporins is involved in the impressive regeneration mechanism of axolotl? And as we know, the species lives in water and can pretty much regenerate from any kind of wounds. So perhaps that is all from me. Thank you.
Thank you for those very insightful questions. The first question is, are there similarities between aquaporins from animals, plants, and humans? And the answer is there are very strong similarities, but they're not identical. All of them are about 28 kilodaltons in size, and they have conserved domains in the pore lining regions. I skipped through that rather rapidly in the talk because I think it's not going to be of interest to everybody, but it might be of interest to you. These pore lining regions that surround the water pore are most highly conserved, almost exactly conserved, with a 3 amino acid repeat, asparagine, proline, alanine, and the outer membrane and the inner membrane coming together forming the pore. So they're clearly recognizable similarities. And you can't necessarily look at a sequence and say, this is human, this is rat, this is plant, you have to know more, because they're very similar. Now, the second question was about the regeneration in tissues, and you mentioned the axolotls and amphibian, for which if you cut off a limb, it'll grow it back. And that's very interesting. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could develop similar techniques for humans who have injuries? Some crippling injury could be restored by growing a new limb. The answer is, I'm sure the aquaporins are involved, but I don't know how. So isn't that cruel? I think I know the answer, but I don't know the question. How can we use this? And I think more research is clearly going to be needed, and I suspect that your laboratory may have the best ideas yet. So I'll turn it on you. Please go for it and let me know what you find. You may be the first scientist from ITB to win a Nobel Prize. Wouldn't that be nice? I hope so. Thank you.
Okay, now the next sessions. I want to hear questions or comments or things to be discussed from the senior scientists. Yeah. One in the middle. Okay. Now the other two from the right hand side. No? From the left one. Okay. Please come forward. Ibu Marcelina from Biology Department.
My name is Marcelina from School of Life Sciences and Technology. I have some basics questions about the polymorphism of the aquaporin. So you mentioned before about the polymorphism. Is there any data from the kind of the polymorphism which can affect to the several phenotype of the persons of human beings? And then the second question about the you mentioned that there are also some aquaporin or aqua kirisero porins or aquaporin which can also transport the not only the water but also glycerol, and then it also transport the heavy metal. So how is the mechanism so that they can distinguish between the glycerol and water, or the heavy metals and the water? And is there any mechanism how they bind to the amino acid on the part of the inner side of the channels? And then how can the aquaporin can be regulated actually? Is it only just the regulation is through the osmosis like that, or there are some kind of regulation through the membrane proteins or the signal part, the signals signal pathway like that? Thank you.
Thank you for these questions. The first regards polymorphisms, and I mentioned briefly the aquaporin 1 having a polymorphism, an amino acid substitution in the outer surface. The AQP1 molecule has an alanine in most of us at the 45th residue, but it's a valine in some people. And the difference between the amino acid alanine and valine is a single carbon, very subtle difference. But it turns out this is of significance because the Colton blood group antigen, which is not too important clinically because most of us are Colton AA, but if an individual should be transfused with Colton B blood and they have Colton AA normal blood, they can develop antibodies to it. And it makes me wonder if there are not other polymorphisms which might be responsible for problems. And one that comes to mind is the aquaporin 5, which is in secretory glands. And it might be that there are some autoantibodies that are involved in problems such as Sjogren's, a dry eye, dry mouth syndrome. We don't know. In terms of the cell activity, this is a very interesting phenomenon. I talked about the permeation by water, And then I briefly went through the glycerol transport, so water, H2O, 18 Daltons in mass. Glycerol, 3 carbons, 3 oxygens, and I guess that's 8 hydrogens, a little bit larger. The pore lining residue in the aquaglyceroporins is not exactly the same as in the aquaporins. Basically, and I'll show you with my hands how this must work. The water channel has a narrow pore. The glycerol channel has a little difference in the back side of this channel, allowing a phenylalanine to open up. So the phenylalanine in the pore lining domain, which is unrestricted because the replacement of a histidine in water channels by a glycine in glycerol channels, allows free movement of the phenylalanine to open basically like a trap door, increasing the diameter of the pore. And it's not my work, it's the work of biosimulators, but it indicates that it's a trap door mechanism that allows the 3-carbon polyol to pass through. Your third question then was regulation. And we don't really understand how these things are regulated. And of course, water, H2O, is electrically silent. The great work of Bert Sachmann and Erwin Neher studying ion channel conductance is the measurement of ions across sodium channels, potassium channels. And this is an electrical event. So if there's flickering of a channel, open, shut, open, shut, open, shut, very quickly, they'll see a flicker in electrical tracing. But water is silent, so we can't measure it. But there is one member of the aquaporin family that is electrically active, and it appears to be flickering. So there must be an open, shut probability. The most important and currently well understood form of regulation, I mentioned the aquaporin 2 in collecting duct of kidney, which is vasopressin regulated. So vasopressin is the hormone released from our pituitary glands when we're thirsted. Go out and play tennis on a hot day, your brain senses dehydration and releases vasopressin. The vasopressin then works through the kidney by regulating aquaporin 2, moving from an intracellular site to the surface. When it moves to the surface, then the surface is permeated by water, and we can freely and efficiently conserve water maximally. So it's well recognized. Someone who's fluid overloaded drinks a liter of iced tea, for example. You'll release dilute urine. The same person playing tennis on a hot day who's dehydrated will produce concentrated urine. So the regulation of aquaporin 2 explains that. Thank you for those questions. And there must be other forms of regulation which we don't really know much about. The ability to synthesize and degrade. Chronically thirsted people are more efficient in concentrating their urine than people who are not chronically thirsted. And this has to do with the expression of more aquaporin 2 or less aquaporin 2.
Okay, now, the next questions? From the lab, yep. Kindly mention your name and your institution.
Good afternoon, Mr. My name is Yorga. I graduated from material science from University of Indonesia. I heard about the aquaporin just last year in my research to understand more about the water structure. And we know water is the most abundant material in our planet, but yet it still have characteristic that we just recovered just yet. One small example is about the water tendency to make a cluster. I heard about the icosahedral structure of the water molecule that they tend to become like a big lump of molecule consists of 120 molecules, and also the smaller one like hexagonal shape and also the 20 molecule that dodecahedral shape. What I want to ask, is it also affect the efficiency of the absorption of water to the cell? Because in your illustration, in your slide, you show that the aquaporin channel is transfer one molecule for a time. Is it can accept a bigger molecule? Is it possible or not? Thank you very much.
Thank you for your question. So there's some information in the lay press and television about water having structure. And it's my understanding that really water is a very interesting and perhaps unique molecule because it doesn't have static structure, unless it's frozen, ice. Ice is structured water. But water, H2O, and this was the topic of my father's chemistry lectures to his students. The very first lecture was the chemistry of water. H2O, 18 Daltons in mass. You would predict water to be a gas. And of course, in the atmosphere, water is a gas. Free water molecules bumping into each other. But in fluid, H2O really doesn't exist because of the hydrogen bonding of one hydrogen to an adjacent oxygen. It's not only one oxygen with two hydrogens, it's one oxygen with many hydrogens shared amongst many. So I think chemists often refer to water as, in bulk solution, as H2O to the nth power. So it may be 20 molecules, it may be 120 molecules. It's rapidly shifting. And so the permeation of the water channel, as you mentioned, is water in single file. And that's why it's so unique. Water will move in single file and then can form a bulk solution on the other side of the membrane. Water can pass, but protons in the form of the hydronium ion cannot pass. So we can concentrate our urine while we're excreting acid. And this is very important for us. It's important for plants. Plants will move water into the tonoplast, but not protons. And so it occurs, and it's physically pretty clear how this works. It's almost spiritual. It works so efficiently. And I think the chemistry of water is what makes life on this planet possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the last sessions. There's still another questions or comments from the audiences. Ibu Desi, please come forward. Yeah, probably just last questions.
Thank you very much, Ibu Annie. My name is Desi Natalia from Biochemistry of ITB. I have two questions. The first one is, what is the biggest dream in your life? And do you think you already accomplished that dream yet? And my second one, could you give us a clue for an inhibitor for blocking the aqua glycoporin of the malaria plasmodium? Because here at ITB we have very strong natural product research group and also many researchers working on the malaria. So hopefully that if you can give us a clue, so many of the young scientists here could get that inhibitor. Thank you very much.
So I think you asked what was my biggest fame? And I don't think about fame very much, frankly. It sometimes is astonishing. Driving into Bandung yesterday, I saw a poster with an old man. It was me. It's a little bit out of body. But I think in terms of internal feeling of well-being, the Nobel was wonderful. But it certainly was not the most important reward I felt in my life. And I think if you ask the other laureates who have visited as part of the International Peace Foundation, they probably would say the same thing. As humans, we have a lot of things that we share. And having a wonderful family with children, and now two grandchildren, You know, these little granddaughters of mine who are 1 and 3 years old, they think I'm a nice guy. They don't know anything about the Nobel Prize. I think that tells us about the relative importance of family and prizes. In terms of the inhibitors, I didn't quite catch the question. It's now something that biotech companies are looking for, inhibitors of specific aquaporins. And it's clear that we need to develop new medicines for malaria. I hope I didn't leave the impression that the aquaporins are going to be the best drug target, because they're probably not sufficiently important to the life of the plasmodium. But there'll be plenty of other drug targets that could be important for malaria. And the thing with discovery of medicines is so interesting. The Nobel Prize was awarded to Tu Youyou from China 2 years ago for the discovery of the artemisinins. Artemisinins. Tu Youyou did not discover artemisinins, but she rediscovered that an ancient Chinese medicine used 1,000 years ago to treat fevers in South China had the ability to inhibit and kill malaria parasites. And this was the product of a scientific undertaking actually that occurred during the Vietnam War, when the North Vietnamese military came to China to talk to Prime Minister Mao Zedong and Zhou Enlai about the importance of malaria in the war effort. And of course, war is a bad thing, but sometimes good things result from that. And the rediscovery of the artemisinins. So I think both rediscovering known molecules, applications, new applications of known medicines, and discoveries of new medicines are all going to be important. And they must be administered properly and efficiently. And I think if all of these things happen, malaria will be knocked out. I'm not sure it'll happen within my lifetime, but for you young scientists here, it could happen in your lifetime, and you could play a very important role in that. Thank you.
Yeah. There's still a bit time left, so if there is still a questions or comments from the audiences. Okay, yeah. Please come forward.
Thank you for the opportunity. Good morning, Professor Agri. My name is Bambang Purwanto. I am a medical physiologist from Airlangga University. I would like to ask you 2 questions. The first one is, I'm wondering, how could you eager to analyze the 28 kilodalton contaminant, which later called with the aquaporins? Commonly, we, as the scientists, when we found a contaminant, we have a stressful. But you have a different side of view that you eager to look forward what is the 28 kilodalton is. And the second one is there any aquaporins which voltage gated? Thank you.
Could you repeat the second question, please? I didn't catch that. The second question.
Okay. Is there any aquaporins which voltage gated channels? Some of the aquaporins which you name aquaporin 1 and such, which is there any aquaporin which voltage gated is open and closed by an electrical stimulation or physical stimulation?
Sure, thank you.
Okay,
good questions. So the first question: what caused us to analyze the 28 kilodalton protein? And you're absolutely right. There's a lot of priority in scientists to remain focused. You get a grant The grant is not some kind of free pass to do anything you want. You must work on the project, but sometimes you find something which is more important than what you're looking for. And that happened to us, but we didn't really know it. So let me tell you a true story. My wife will confirm this. We discovered the molecular basis of Rh, which is of clinical importance. Rhd negative mothers pregnant with Rhd positive children could become sensitized, and those antibodies could kill subsequent fetuses during pregnancy. And a 28 kilodalton polypeptide contaminated our preparations. And this was a bitter disappointment. You'd think if you had an antibody to a new protein, that'd be exciting, but it was not what we were looking for, and we were stuck. We didn't know what the 28K protein did. And I talked to many physiologists who were very knowledgeable and very generous with their time. None of them recognized what a channel in red cell membranes could possibly be, and most of them assured me that they didn't have channels. So there's something that we refer to in the United States as work-life balance. 40 years ago when I was a student, no one mentioned it. You worked as hard as you could and you hoped your family did all right. But now we understand having children, and particularly when you have a two-career family, a husband and a wife, each with careers, you must have time set aside for the children. So my wife, Mary, decided it would be wonderful for our children to have the experience that she always wanted as a child but couldn't have, and that's to go camping in the national parks. In the United States, we have wonderful national parks. They're open to the public, not just public of the U.S., but public of all over the world. So we took the children camping in Grand Canyon, Yosemite, Glacier Park, Smoky Mountain National Park, and they loved it. And after a few years, Mary said, let's ask the children next year which national park they want to go camping in. So we said to the kids, which national park would you like to go to? And they all yelled, Disney World. Well, Disney World is a commercial park. It's not a national park. But kids love Mickey Mouse. So we compromised. We went to the Everglades. And then on our way back to Baltimore, which is a very long drive from Orlando, Florida to Baltimore, about 1,500 kilometers, we stopped in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. So we visited Disney World. The kids had a good time. We stopped in Chapel Hill, North Carolina to spend the night with friends. And Mary had friends. The children had playmates. And I had colleagues at Duke University and the University of North Carolina, and I talked to several of them about the nature of this new protein. And it was John Parker, my former professor of hematology, who recognized the importance that this may be and said this might be the long-sought water channel. Because physiologists have been looking for the explanation for rapid osmosis for more than 100 years. It was John's suggestion that caused it. And while John died a couple of years after that suggestion, I've never forgotten his importance in providing generously an idea to a young scientist that led to a Nobel Prize. So if you're still with us, I'd thank him in person, but he's gone, I can't, but I think acknowledging the generosity of older colleagues to share the knowledge. The second question was still a little unclear to me about the notion that aquaporins might be gated like ion channels, and what is the mechanism? To my knowledge, AQP6 is the only aquaporin which has an ion conductance. And it appears to be rapidly flickering, and the rate of flickering increases at lower pH. So there must be some structural modification that occurs which is facilitated at lower pH, causing the channel to be open more often than not. And if that's true, it should probably apply to all the other aquaporins. But I'm afraid I disappoint you because I don't have a better biophysical understanding of it. But thank you for sharing your question. And I think when our kids ask us to take them to Disney World, sometimes that's a pretty good idea.
Okay. Time flies so fast, and I think we have to end this magnificent session. I thank you very much for all participants from the audiences. Now, to end this wonderful Nobel lecture and dialogue, as a big appreciation, I invite all of the audiences to stand up and give a big applause for the Nobel laureate in chemistry, Professor Peter Agrey. Thank you.